Okay, we're going to continue the discussion on medical ethics. I'm going to kind of begin where we left off with euthanasia and so forth, and a little bit of review at the beginning. There's the caduceus, first no harm, the oath of the medical profession. As review, why do we need medical ethics? Okay, then it's due to the loss of our proper worldview. The predominant worldview in our culture is no longer biblical or even theistic. And so the logical outcomes of evolution are what? Racism, genocide, medical ethics boards, socialized medicine, healthcare rationing, and of course eugenics. And today we're going to talk about genetic engineering and basically where it is today in the scientific community. Evolutionists don't like to acknowledge the social implications of their theory. And of course, racism and the genocide in Germany and even in early U.S. history, not early U.S. history, but the 1900s of U.S. history is testimony to the fact that evolution does affect our view of human life. So remember the root of the problem, shift in worldview. Why are all those things a logical result of evolution? Why is it logical that people will become racist if they have evolution as a foundation? Why is it logical that the sanctity of human life is going to decline? Because of these reasons. Destroys God's authority. No absolutes. No moral absolutes. No ethical absolutes. And so on. So we're going to continue with this and review the biblical worldview. Make sure you have, well, you should already have, but make sure you know your biblical worldview. And here we're talking specifically the God of the Bible, in contrast to just a theistic worldview. The God of the Bible is the true God, and he reveals himself through his word, the Bible. So what is a proper view of God? He's the sovereign creator. And then I did give you those five attributes. Several of you did not answer that on your abortion questions. What's the proper view of man? Man is God's special creation. Now, the ethical questions we began to look at, of course, were abortion and euthanasia. We talked about judicial murder, dealing with Terry Schiavo. And we're going to talk a little bit and finish up today with the assisted suicide, or so-called death with dignity. But there are other ethical questions involved with medical ethics. Medical research is the main focus of today's lecture. Stem cell use, is it ethical? When is it ethical? Fetal tissue use, is it ethical? Genetic engineering and even human cloning. I also added animal research. There's a difference between human research, clinical trials, genetic engineering, and animal research. Keep in mind that animals have a different place in a biblical worldview. There are no animal rights in the Bible. All we really have in the Bible is the humane treatment of animals. So there's nothing wrong with animal research. Animal research has basically given us most of our medical advances, especially in the last several decades. So remember, there's no such thing as animal rights. Animals are not persons. So we don't have a problem with, I don't think you should either, have a problem with animal research, as long as it's done humanely. All right, so as a review, what is abortion? I gave you the pro-choice definition, but of course this would be the more accurate definition. It is premeditated murder of an unborn child, and it is violent, okay, and it destroys human life. What about euthanasia? Euthanasia is certainly not as violent, though I don't know. In the case of Terry Schiavo, it certainly was not a pleasant death. But is the premature ending the life of another person with or without their consent? And here's where we start getting into trouble. Quality of life And even when a person has a terminal illness, should they be allowed to, with the help of modern medicine, end their life? All right, of course, Terry Schiavo was an example of judicial murder. Who decided that Terry Schiavo needed to die? Essentially, a couple of federal judges on the mistaken idea that that's what she would want, even though there was no proof of that. In fact, maybe even some indications to the contrary. So Terry Schiavo is an example of what I'm calling judicial murder. There's no other way to put it. And of course, why do we have ethical dilemmas and problems and issues in medicine and dealing with abortion and dealing with quality of life and so forth? And that is because we've lost our biblical worldview. And without our biblical worldview, we don't recognize a higher law. There is no absolutes, okay? We don't have the Bible and we don't have God to give us a basis of our opinions. And so more and more, it's going to be whatever the opinion is of that day. So we have no higher law. And also, we've gotten away from, in our government, a constitutional law. Now, what is legal or not legal is decided by 9 members of the Supreme Court or possibly other judges lower in the federal court system or even in the state system. So we have no higher law. Now we have man's opinion, and we've changed our legal system and given way too much power to our Supreme Court to be able to overturn laws that the legislature has properly passed and so forth. And as we're dealing with medical ethics, I'm going to come back to 2 lines that should never be crossed. And when you're trying to decide if something is ethical or so on, obviously genetic engineering is not in the Bible any more than smoking is not in the Bible, but there are Bible principles. And I think one of the things that we have to recognize is God's authority as creator. So that's an absolute. God has authority, and the Bible is not just an ancient book of literature for us to, you know, read in literature class. It is God's revealed will to man. So we need to recognize God's authority. God is both the giver and taker of life. It is God who should decide who lives and dies. It is God who should decide what's right and what's wrong, and he has in the Bible. That's a line that we should not cross, God's authority. God is the giver and taker of life. And then another line is the idea of destroying human life at any stage, whether we're talking about a few-day-old human embryo, we're talking about a 12-week-old so-called fetus, so we're talking about a 24-week so-called fetus, which is actually an unborn child. There's no difference, remember, something you should have gotten from the abortion DVDs, the fact that human life is indistinguishable at any stage. So that should be an absolute, all right? Taking a life is never ethical at any stage for any reason. Of course, I hope you don't believe that the end justifies the means. Okay, that's not a biblical philosophy. So what is a proper view of life and death? I think you know this, but you need to be more and more aware of it. Life and death are in God's hand. God is both the giver and taker of life, and you may in the future need to seek his will specifically with a life and death situation in your own family or in your own ministry. Here's kind of where we left off. Quality of life is a slippery slope. When we try to decide, in the example of Terry Schiavo, about her quality of life. Did she want to live in that stage? Is that a life worthy to be lived? Well, the quality of life denies equal dignity. The equal dignity and importance of all human life. Remember, human life is sacred. We believe in the dignity of human life because man was created by God and in God's image. And it is God that from the very beginning has given us life. And it does imply that living with limitations or living with disability or other handicaps is a life not worth living. Who should be determining that? certainly not man, certainly not insurance companies, certainly not medical ethics boards. It also has the idea that it's an undue burden on society. It's a burden on the family and so forth. But many, many people can give testimony to the fact that they derive value out of caring for loved ones and so forth. It's not an inconvenience. It's not an expense. In fact, the Bible talks about not having natural affection, doesn't it? Okay. And so it is part of our responsibility and duty as humans to care for others around us, especially those of our own family. And it embraces the idea that elderly and handicapped people are a burden on society or a burden on the family or too expensive. So how are we going to start having trouble with assisted suicide? We already do, and it's going to become more and more of a problem. How is this going to come about? And I think the illustration of Brittany Maynard, where we left off at the last time, is a good indication of how this will come about. Okay, Brittany Maynard is an example of assisted suicide. She took her own life on November 1st, 2014, by taking a solution of different medications and respiratory depressants that eventually slowed her breathing and caused her to die. She was 29 years old. She had an aggressive terminal brain cancer. And of course, she moved to Oregon and so forth. And she has become a death with dignity, even after her death, by partnering with this group called Compassion with Choices. Of course, Brittany Maynard attained almost celebrity status by publicizing her decision to end her life. This, of course, is the cover of People magazine, a celebrity tabloid type publication, and so on. So, Compassion and Choices, formerly named the Hemlock Society. What would hemlock be associated with? It's poison, taking your own life, or possibly poisoning someone else. Of course, that's not a very politically correct or attractive name, so they are now called Compassion and Choices. So now it's going to be compassionate to take the life of another person or to assist them in taking their own life, giving them an end-of-life choice. And actually, death becomes a treatment option under the guise of compassion and choice. You can see here's a quote from the website of Compassion and Choices. It says, "Medical aid in dying is a natural and central component of patient-centered end-of-life care. However, it is only a start. To truly transform end-of-life care in this country, we need to stop the conveyor belt of over-treatment and false promises. We need to ensure that healthcare providers give people complete information about all their end-of-life care options." Okay, it does sound like treatment, doesn't it? And it sounds good, you know, patient-centered end-of-life care is the only way to ensure patients make fully informed treatment decisions. I didn't realize death was a treatment option. Accelerating your death being a treatment option. So here's Brittany's impact through this advocacy group. Of course, this is a quote from their president, Barbara Combs Lee. It says, "Brittany came on the scene and set in motion a chain of events leading to the passage of," here it is, "Aid in Dying Bill through California." Of course, she had to move to Oregon because at the time of her death in 2014, there were only 5 states that had any aid in dying medication. All the other states, it was illegal to prescribe lethal medication. So you can see they've been working on this since 1991. But by 2014, After Brittany's death, you can see they exploited her. Lawmakers in 25 jurisdictions plus the District of Columbia have now introduced end-of-life or aid-in-dying bills or death with dignity legislation. So the results of this type of thing happening in our culture, this type of legislature being passed at the state level, is we are going to accept death as a healthcare option. I'd imagine, especially as it doesn't apply to us personally, as in the case of Terry Schiavo. This also is an opening wedge, okay? And this is going to be the first step in allowing other forms of euthanasia besides assisted suicide. It sets in motion the slippery slope to expand euthanasia beyond choice and terminal illness. And of course, goes back to our worldview. The end justifies the means. My intentions were good. That doesn't change the fact that it is immoral and unethical. I have three women here that I mentioned last time, and I want to look at their view on death. Because as a Christian, we don't need to take Brittany Maynard's view of her death. She was obsessed with having control of when and how she would die. Okay, and in order to do that, she took prescribed medication actually well before she was incapacitated. She was afraid of becoming incapacitated and not being able to use her prescription. So that's why she literally set the date of November 1st. So with Brittany Maynard, she of course doesn't want to call it suicide, but that's what happened. She took her own life. And basically, she was wanting to choose her timing and manner of death. And then she also became an advocate, both before and after her death, to promote aid in dying as a treatment option. All right, as a Christian, this is obviously not a biblical way to approach death and dying. I have the other two women. First, Kara Tippetts. She passed away of breast cancer and as a relatively young woman. And you can see her view on death. She knows she's going to die. But what does she have that Brittany Maynard did not have? She has a relationship with God. Okay. And even the next woman, Maggie Cardner. Maggie, of course, was not as young as Brittany Maynard. She was in her early 50s, but she had the identical tumor and cancer type, a very aggressive and untreatable brain tumor. You can see her view of her own death. She wasn't trying, as Brittany Maynard did, to grasp personal control over the circumstances and timing of her death. Why? Well, it's part of God's will for her life. Remember, when we have an evolutionary, non-biblical worldview, we're going to want control of that. And we're not going to be able to accept God's providence in our life or in the lives of our loved ones. So she realizes that she doesn't need control over her own death. And what God wants her to do, obviously, is to accept it and so forth. So she has a more proper view of death, you say. And I think she's a good testimony to that because here she is facing her death. Okay, it's one thing for us to talk about it now when it doesn't apply to any of us, but you can see you can have the proper view of death if you have Christ as your Savior and you realize that death is not the end. So conclusion, unfortunately, death is part of living, and so as a Christian, you should have a proper view of death. Death is not a treatment option. Okay. Death is always out of our hands. None of us in here know the manner and timing of our death. And so death is, and for the Christian, well, for all people, death is not the end. And, of course, we talk about death with dignity. There is no such thing as death with dignity. So it is important for us as Christians to have a proper view of death, not just our own, but of our loved ones and so forth. And as a Christian, our view of death should be nowhere near the view of death of a Brittany Maynard or other unsaved person. So that is the end of euthanasia and dealing with death, because it is something that we will face, and we need to have a proper view of both life and death. Ethical concerns in research. All right, when we're dealing with research, there's a couple of distinctions that we need to make. The first distinction, of course, would be animal life versus human life. Is there a distinction between animal life and human life? That line becomes blurred if you're an evolutionist, doesn't it? But that line is very distinct if you have a biblical view of man, if you view man as created in God's image. So, of course, the first thing is animal research. As I mentioned at the beginning, animal research is ethical. Why? I assume that you believe animal research is ethical. Maybe you do not. Maybe you have some reservations about it. But from the Bible, is animal research ethical? What does the Bible say about animals other than humane treatment and even making exceptions to Levitical law about if something happens on the Sabbath day, being able to save the life of your animal? But what does the Bible have to say? Yes? Exactly. And so there's a big difference between animal trials in medical research and clinical trials. All right. Animal research is not against the Bible. As mentioned, we do have a biblical mandate, and man does have a higher place than animals. Basically, the only thing we need to be sure of is that humane treatment of animals is followed. And in fact, in the United States, animal research is highly regulated by the FDA. So animal research is ethical because animals are not persons. We're not given the image of God. Animals are distinct from human beings. And so I really think that you need to realize there is no such thing as animal rights. Humane treatment of animals, yes. Animal rights, no. It's not biblical. So medical research. Where do we have a problem with medical research? Where should we have a problem with medical research? The use of aborted fetuses. Sometimes this is justified. Well, these babies were aborted anyways. Why not benefit from using fetal tissue in research? Why not benefit from using fetal cells to help determine how cells behave and how cells respond and so forth? Another problem that we'd have, of course, is the use of human embryos. A human embryo is a fertilized egg, and when we're dealing with human embryos, we're mostly dealing with the stage referred to as the blastocyst, a 3 to 5 day old fertilized embryo. We also have a problem with the manipulation of the human genome. Why would we have a problem with, aborted fetuses? We've crossed the line of destroying human life. The same reason is true why we have a problem with the use of human embryos for experimentation, because we're crossing the line of destroying human life at whatever stage. Why do we have a problem with the manipulation of the human genome? We're starting to cross and get very close to and step over the line of God's authority. God is the giver and taker of life, not man. Human cloning, ? Has that been done yet? No, an entire human being has not been cloned. In fact, it's illegal. But could it happen? Will it happen? Well, the technology is exploding in the last 5 years with genetic engineering, as we'll talk about in just a minute. So remember, these are controversial. Some of them are unethical, if not immoral, because it involves the taking of human life. Okay, we're talking about abortion and then using fetal tissue, or we're talking about embryonic stem cell use and embryonic stem cell research that involves the destruction of human life. So, of course, those practices would be wrong. But what if we try to do good? What if we try to do good with this fetal tissue or the embryonic stem cells or anything else that might cross our ethical lines? What if, does the end justify the means? These last two, the giving of human life, is it ethical to assist couples in having children if it involves the destruction of human life? What about curing diseases? What about bettering human life? Are those excuses valid for crossing the lines that we've laid down, crossing the lines of destroying human life or crossing the line of God's authority? So we do have different areas of controversy. We've kind of already dealt with the taking of human life, whether it's abortion or euthanasia. But what, as I said before, what if taking of human life has a good outcome? What if we're trying to accomplish the so-called greater good? Is it ethical? All right, so let's talk about these. First of all, the giving of human life. Is it ethical to destroy human life in order to assist couples in having children? Or are we crossing both of those lines? What are those two lines? Destruction of human life and God's authority. God's the giver and taker of life. You've probably heard of in vitro fertilization, always abbreviated IVF. And of course, this is when we are going to outside of the body, that's referred to as in vitro. You'll see those words in this presentation a little bit. In vitro has the idea, it literally means in glass. And this is when our procedure is done outside of the body. If you see the little phrase in vivo means inside the body. So in vitro fertilization is when we construct human embryos outside of the human body and then implant them in the mother so that the couple can have children. What is the problem with in vitro fertilization? Well, it's unethical because we are attempting to give life, bypassing God's and God's providence. It's also unethical because of the techniques used. In order to, the terminology is put this way, in order to get a viable embryo, we have to create numerous embryos and then implant several of them and then store the rest of them. What are we going to do with those human embryos? Of course, that's the excuse for using embryonic stem cells, as we have all these human embryos from the in vitro fertilization clinics, why not use them for the greater good? But here we're getting into God's territory, and here we're crossing ethical and moral lines, okay? So even the so-called good outcome of allowing a couple to have children does not excuse or allow us to cross the lines and start manufacturing human embryos in the laboratory. And this course is done all the time. All right, but that doesn't make it ethical. All right, so when we're giving, when we're involving with the giving of human life or even the preventing of it, we have to be very careful about crossing the line of destroying human life and crossing the line of God's authority. You also, I don't have it on the slide, but I need to mention it here. You also need to be very careful with birth control when you get to that stage in your life, okay? Because we have to make sure that we are not crossing the line of destroying human life. And there are methods of birth control that do that. So when you get to that stage in your life in the future, you would not choose in vitro fertilization. Okay, God is the giver of life. And you also need to be very aware of different birth control techniques and speak to your physician about them. Because otherwise, we're being inconsistent. If we're against abortion, we also have to be against other things that destroy the human embryo, whether it's in vitro fertilization, certain forms of birth control, certain forms of medical research. So we need to be consistent across the line, and you need to be aware that that could be a problem. Then the next thing, as far as giving human life, is genetic engineering. And in the last 5 years, we have develop the technology to be able to do this. Okay, we're going to cover it in just a minute. Human cloning. Basically, there's two types of cloning, reproductive cloning and therapeutic cloning. Are those ethical? What is involved in those processes? Of course, reproductive cloning would be involving producing certain characteristics or choosing gender and so forth in children, and that type of cloning is illegal in most countries, but a lot of it is not very highly regulated because the technology is too new. So we can have a problem not just with abortion, not just with euthanasia. We can also have a problem when we're talking about giving of human life. Okay, so you need to be aware of that, especially for your life in the future. Then another problem that comes up, another area is, how ethical is it to use human embryos to better the lives of people? Whether it's treating serious illness or even eliminating certain genetic diseases, is that ethical? And as I mentioned a few minutes ago, the genetic engineering technology has exploded, especially since 2012, in the last 5 years. And these technologies are in place, and some of them are actually, according to their developers, relatively easy to do. I don't know how easy it would be in our view, but this technology, as I said, has just exploded, and we do not have regulations in place to monitor it and so forth. So the betterment of human life would involve embryonic stem cell research. Now, not all stem cell research is embryonic. We can use somatic stem cells, and that comes from a living adult, and usually, of course, the patient themselves, and it does not involve destroying their life. So embryonic stem cell research is an area of controversy because of in vitro fertilization techniques of the past. We literally have excess human embryos. So, of course, the idea is, why not use them? Fetal tissue use, the same thing. Abortion is legal. We do have available tissues left over from abortion. They kind of, if you think about it, what does that sound like? That sounds like the human experimentations that were done in Nazi Germany. Okay, what's the difference if it was, if the research is done with an older person, an adult, or if the research is done on a baby, an unborn child? Therapeutic cloning. Okay, therapeutic cloning is when we deliberately make certain embryos and harvest certain characteristics from them. And of course, in order to do so, it destroys the embryo because all we're doing is harvesting their stem cells. And then therapeutic genetic engineering. This is where we are right now. Gene-based medicines. Some of this technology is ethical because it does not involve the destruction of human life. But much of it was derived from research that we would deem unethical. So there are a lot of new technologies involved here and a lot of ethical dilemmas and a lot of scary things that could happen. This is no longer science fiction. Okay? So what about these new technologies? Where do they fit? Are they ethical? Are they moral? Are they in line with what the Bible principles would tell us? Stem cell research. How many have heard of stem cells? Do you know what they are? Well, a stem cell is a general name for a precursor cell. A stem cell is a precursor cell. It has not developed into any particular cell line or any particular cell type or tissue. When we're talking about stem cells, many times you'll see the word undifferentiated. So that's a key to understanding what stem cells are. Stem cells are undifferentiated. That means it's immature, it's undeveloped, But at the same time, the second important word to understand with stem cells is the word potential. They theoretically can develop into any cell type. So some researchers refer to them as key blanks. All we have to do is imprint upon them the characteristics that we want them to display, and they will develop into a nerve cell, or develop into liver cells, or develop into certain blood cells. And if we can direct that, then we're well on the way to curing certain diseases and making certain treatments available. And the reason why this is important, and the reason why so much research has been done with it, is that many types of cells in your body do not reproduce themselves very much at all, or at all, or very efficiently. One of which, of course, are neurons. Neurons are brain cells, and neurons do not typically replace themselves. So if you have a brain or spinal cord injury, the body does not repair the damage, the body simply fills it in with scar tissue. So this type of research has been highly promoted for neurological disorders such as Parkinson's, even Alzheimer's, and of course spinal cord injury. Because if we can get stem cells to differentiate into neurons, then we can repair stem cell injuries. And we can reverse paralysis, or we can reverse brain damage, especially traumatic brain damage, or even the type of brain damage that Terry Schiavo had due to oxygen deprivation. So this could be a very exciting field and open all kinds of treatment options to better human life, to treat severe injury, to treat severe illness. And of course, so stem cells do have a potential. And if we can get them to develop into different tissue types, we can repair and replace damaged tissue. And that's the idea. Get stem cells to differentiate into any cell type we need so we can repair and replace. So, stem cell. All right, so a stem cell is our key blank. It's kind of a generic cell, and it has all of the DNA of the entire person. So that means it has the DNA capabilities to become any one of the 220 or so different human cell types. And that gives us the ability to repair and replace damaged tissues. So there are three levels of potency that you will see referred to with stem cells. The first is called totipotent. And of course, this is dealing with the embryo as a whole. The embryo as a whole has the potential to develop into an entire person, which is why we are concerned with the destruction of and the indiscriminate use of and even the indiscriminate production of human embryos in vitro, in laboratory situations. It's unethical to just start putting together human embryos so that we can study them, so that we can develop treatments and so forth. The entire embryo is referred to as being totipotent. The other two levels of potency are what we're interested in, pluripotency and multipotency. Something that is pluripotent has the potential, remember, it's potential. It's theoretical, the potential to develop into any one of 220 different human cell types. Of course, embryonic stem cells are viewed as being pluripotent. The lowest level is multipotent, and these are cells that can only differentiate into a very small group of cell types based on where we got the stem cell. For example, blood stem cells are associated with blood, obviously, and so blood stem cells typically will only differentiate into the different kinds of blood cells. There are also stem cells found throughout the body, and they will be able to differentiate into a few different cell types. That's referred to as multipotent. So the argument here is that the two types of stem cells that exist, embryonic, taken from a human embryo, or somatic, the so-called adult stem cells that are taken from an adult donor. And the argument is, well, embryonic stem cells are pluripotent, somatic or adult stem cells are only multipotent. We need to use embryonic. That's the argument. So you can see we've got, here is an embryonic stem cell procedure where this is the blastocyst, where you can see that it is 3 to 5 days old, and they will harvest the stem cells out of the blastocyst, in effect destroying it, and then culture those cells in vivo. And so the embryo itself is totipotent, whereas the blastocyst, once we harvest the stem cells from it, it's supposedly pluripotent. And we would like to be able to get them to differentiate into neurons so we can repair and replace damaged nervous tissue. That would take care of a lot of diseases and injury issues. Or that's cardiac muscle. We can repair heart damage, you know, due to heart attack and other things. Or, of course, we already can produce red blood cells and different types of blood cells from bone marrow, so we really don't need that one. I keep mentioning two types of stem cells. Here's the details. The first type of stem cell is embryonic. And this, of course, to get embryonic stem cells, we have to destroy the embryo or harvest them from fetal tissue or at some stage in the development of the human child, we would harvest its stem cells. So most embryonic stem cells are taken from the 3 to 5 day old human embryo. And that human embryo, called the blastocyst, is a mass of human cells, basically just a mass of stem cells encased in a membrane. Sources of embryonic stem cells are in vitro fertilization clinics. We already have them. And so the idea is, why not use them? Aborted fetuses, and there are existing human cell lines. Stem cell research was highly controversial during the Bush presidency and George W. Bush presidency, and he put a moratorium on stem cell research, and research could only be done on existing human cell lines that were in existence at various universities pretty much and other research labs. Of course, when President Obama took office, he lifted those moratoriums, and during his presidency, the genetic engineering technology just exploded. According to theory, embryonic stem cells are pluripotent, meaning they could potentially, theoretically, develop into any one of the cells that we might need for our treatment. So here we have pluripotent stem cell diagram again. There is the fertilized human egg cell, which after a few days becomes the blastocyst. And we will destroy the blastocyst, destroy the embryo, in order to harvest what are believed to be pluripotent stem cells. Okay, so the second type, this type does not have the ethical concerns of the first type. These are called somatic stem cells, also referred to as adult stem cells. These are taken from a specific body tissue in an adult donor. So obviously it does not require the death of the donor. And actually these are better, because we can harvest cells from the patient themselves, and then the cells will have the same genetic makeup. And so then we can also harvest them from donors that are matched to the patient. These are also found in cord blood. This was a big thing where people were preserving the umbilical cords of their children, cryogenically preserving them so that if they had a problem later on, they'd have their own stem cells. Is that ethical? Well, it does not destroy the human life. So I suppose we could say that that does not violate the main line that we're dealing with, the ethical line of destruction of human life. We can also find them from cadavers. Potential. The potential here is that these cells are only multipotent. However, with the new technology, we are more and more going to be able to make these pluripotent. And you will see the technology that I'm talking about is actually genetic engineering. So in reality, stem cell research and so forth is becoming less and less an issue because it is no longer the cutting edge of genetic technology. Genetic technology will be switching to genetic engineering. But somatic cells can come from various locations in a donor's body. And so more and more we can see that we do not need the embryonic stem cells. We don't need them. So with stem cell research, what is the controversy? We're back to those two lines, the absolute of God's authority and the absolute of destroying a human life. Taking a life, whether it's an embryo or a fetus or an unborn child or a handicapped person, is never ethical. So the controversy with stem cell research was the source of the stem cells, not the technology itself. Okay, embryonic stem cells involve the destruction of the human embryo, and that's an unethical line we should be unwilling to cross. Somatic stem cells do not have that issue, does not involve the death of the donor. So here's a little contrast between the two types, embryonic versus adult stem cells. Obviously, the entire embryo is totipotent, but the stem cells themselves are only pluripotent. Adult stem cells, more and more, are becoming pluripotent. But we do have issues with adult stem cells. They are limited in number, and they are difficult sometimes to locate and harvest because we have an entire adult person. But we do have, notice, less moral and legal controversy. But we also have some pluses in the fact that we can have reaction to treatments from embryonic stem cells because the embryo does not have our genetic makeup. Whereas if we use a somatic cell from the patient himself, the genetic makeup is the same. So we have other problems we're going to deal with. So what's wrong with stem cell research? There are five arguments against using embryonic stem cells, not stem cells in general. Embryonic stem cell research involves both the creation of, in the laboratory, and the destruction of human embryos. That is an unethical line we need to be unwilling to cross. It does overstep God's authority, and it destroys human life. I believe we're crossing both lines there. So then when we are dealing with embryonic stem cells, we will be creating embryos in the lab, and then we will be destroying embryos to get to their stem cells. So that's the other ethical line we need to be unwilling to cross. So when we're using embryonic stem cells, first thing we do wrong is we create embryos in the laboratory. The second thing we do wrong is we destroy those embryos in order to get their stem cells. And of course, we may try to justify ourselves. It doesn't matter how good our intentions are. Maybe in a case of in vitro fertilization, we want to allow a childless couple to have a baby. That's a good intention, but that doesn't excuse crossing ethical lines. We might have the good intention of curing Alzheimer's or Parkinson's or spinal cord damage, but that does not ever justify the use of these stem cells. Also, more and more we're finding that embryonic stem cells are unnecessary. we're having better success with somatic cells. We don't have the immune rejection because we have our own DNA. We don't have the chance of tumor formation because we are not dealing with foreign cells. And we also have a false hope. Celebrity promotions were very popular in the past. We were touting that, oh, we can cure juvenile diabetes. We can repair damaged spinal cords. We can reverse Alzheimer's. We can reverse Parkinson's. And of course, there were very famous people involved. Nancy Reagan was a big pro stem cell research, especially after her husband, President Ronald Reagan, was diagnosed with and eventually died of Alzheimer's and Alzheimer's complications. Mary Tyler Moore, famous actress, in fact, she recently passed away, had juvenile diabetes. And so she was on the bandwagon of we've got to advance human stem cell research because then we can repair or replace pancreatic tissue that's not producing the insulin the body needs. Christopher Reeves, another actor who had a spinal cord injury and was paralyzed. He also has passed away. Then Michael J. Fox is another actor. What do we have here? We have all this false hope and all this literal propaganda, how we've got to use embryonic stem cells. We're going to cure diabetes. We're going to cure Alzheimer's. And in fact, that was nowhere near plausible, especially at the time that we're talking here. There are problems with embryonic stem cells. We do have health risks. It's not all rosy as promoted by these celebrities. There's problems with it. It is not going to be a cure-all. There are always side effects. I mentioned immune rejections. When we use embryonic stem cells, they have different DNA. All right, and then we also have a problem with tumor formation with using embryonic stem cell-derived cells and tissues. And also, slippery slope, black market for surplus embryos. In vitro fertilization clinics can sell those embryos for a huge profit, or abortion clinics selling the fetal tissue for a huge profit. You notice that was a problem with abortion. Why is the abortion industry called that? Because it's a money maker, all right? And so we always have that money problem. Profiting at the expense of others is always going to be a driving factor. The last thing I want to talk about is genetic engineering and the newer technology. What's next? I've got some pictures here. We have new technology. It's called CRISPR-Cas9. Okay, CRISPR-Cas9. This is invented or developed in 2012 by mostly at the University of California, Berkeley, by two genetic engineers. One of them, her name is Jennifer Duda, and she, of course, there's all these patent fights between a couple different laboratories and so forth. And genetic engineering is the way it's going to go in the future. They are working on therapeutic uses, directly being able to, here's what they do. They remove cells from the patient. They alter their genetic makeup in the lab, and then they re-inject it. Or they may do it in vivo, where they're going to try to get the cells to do that on their own. Another thing that they have done with this new technology is they have designed animals to mimic human diseases. They're called animal models. They're called genome-engineered animals. They have been successful with most mammals, including primates. Okay, and they've developed animal models to study certain diseases and to study how the cells react. Here's where we have a problem. Germline uses. That's when we start messing with the genetic makeup of the reproductive cells and actually stepping into reproductive uses, not just therapeutic uses. Human germline modifications. That will be happening in the future if it isn't already, where we will eliminate the gene for cystic fibrosis. Actually, they are able to repair the human genome artificially. Designer babies is no longer science fiction. This next slide. This next slide was actually used in a presentation that I watched by Jennifer Duda. Okay, designer babies, genetically enhancing the human genome. Okay, so, and of course, this would also be done through in vitro fertilization techniques, being able to choose the characteristics of the child. And it's not beyond the realm of possibility anymore with this new technology called CRISPR-Cas9. Okay, you can see CRISPR stands for clustered regularly interspaced short palindromic repeats. Okay, and this was actually developed when they were studying bacteria. And they discovered that bacteria actually can, remember when we talked about our immune system and how we can adapt to the next encounter with a pathogen? Bacteria is actually able to do that by incorporating small pieces of the viral DNA into its genome. So the next time that same virus attacks the bacteria, it has a protein that'll cut that out and destroy it. So what we've done is we've hijacked this protein called CRISPR, and then Cas9 is the protein, and this deals with, it has two parts to it. It has a protein, is actually able to cut through DNA, and then it has a RNA guide in an RNA portion that delivers this to exactly the correct location in the genome. It's very sophisticated in its specificity, but it's actually a very simple, supposedly a very simple technique. So we do have genetic engineering. It's not just on the horizon, it's already here. And how is it going to be used? That is going to be all kinds of ethical questions. All right, CRISPR-Cas9 is referred to as a gene editing. What does that mean? That means if you carry the gene for cystic fibrosis, we can cut it out of your DNA and replace it with the correct gene. Okay, it is referred to as a gene delivery system. And what we're able to do is correct a specific gene or insert a specific gene. And then it's sometimes referred to, and this is where it gets a little scary, as a gene drive, able to completely change the genetic makeup of a population. What they want to do right now is genetically engineer the Anopheles mosquito so that it will eventually become extinct. That sounds good, but that could be very, very dangerous. So a lot of what used to be science fiction is no longer science fiction. It is the future. And with the discovery of this technique, and this technique is becoming more and more available, it's becoming more and more sophisticated, genetic engineering is here, and it's probably here to stay. Conclusion. Medical research is an important part of medicine, but it also, our advancing technology is going to be providing or causing and bringing up more and more ethical dilemmas. So it's important for you to have that biblical worldview and understand what should be ethical according to the Bible and what is not. And I think those two lines I keep bringing up are important to remember. Remember God's authority and God's providence in the life of people. And remember that there is a distinction between animal life and all other life. It is unethical to manipulate the human genome. It's unethical to destroy human life, no matter what our good intentions might be. Here's a picture of the Cas9 protein repairing a section of DNA. Of course, this is computer graphics. All right, this is not a photograph. But genetic engineering is here to stay. What do you think about it? Okay, it's in the very near future. The technology is here. Okay, so we have to address the ethical considerations of it. All right, we'll see you on Thursday.